Hey, NCC family, thank you so much for joining us today. We're going to be wrapping up our Jesus series today, but I want to tell you a little bit about what's coming in these next few weeks. We're going to be doing a three-week series entitled Simple Prayers. We're going to be going through the Lord's Prayer each week, but it's not just a Sunday morning thing, because on Sunday night at 6 p.m., right here in the building at NCC, we're going to be praying from 6 to 6:45. And then right after that, we're going to have a time of food and fellowship and fun. It's going to be an awesome time, families coming together. So we're going to pray together. We're going to eat together, have fun together. I really hope that you will make the choice to be a part of this Sunday experience, not just Sunday mornings, but also Sunday evenings, as we are going through the Lord's Prayer, as we're in a time and a season of prayer for our 21 days of prayer for the fall. It's going to be an awesome time, and I'm really, really, really pumped about these next few weeks. Well, as you know, we have been in a series this summer entitled Jesus. And we're not just talking about who Jesus was or what Jesus did, but more specifically, how Jesus lived. And as Jesus followers, as Christians, not just how Jesus lived, but also how we should live. Because the Bible tells us in Romans chapter 8 that the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, the very Spirit of Christ, is living and dwelling on the inside of us. And if that is true, then what we see in him should also be seen in us. What we see in Jesus in the scriptures should be seen in our lives today. And now you may be thinking, okay, well, what does that really look like? What does it look like when the Spirit of Christ is living and ruling and reigning on the inside of your heart? And the Apostle Paul gives us a little glimpse of what the Holy Spirit, what the Spirit of Christ would produce in our lives. And he tells us this in Galatians chapter 5. He says, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Now, let's stop right there and just say this, that this is what the Holy Spirit produces. So if the Holy Spirit is producing it, it is supernatural. The Holy Spirit will produce these things: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, here we are at the very end of this series. And so today, we are going to be talking about self-control. And while though that definition might be self-explanatory, let's take a closer look at it. How do we, right now, in the English language, define self-control? It's defined as this: the ability to control oneself, in particular, one's emotions and desires, or the expression of them in one's behavior, especially in difficult situations. Now, I would like to just take that definition right there and maybe create a little working definition for us of what are we really talking about, maybe to simplify that a little bit, expound upon it, and say, what are we really talking about when we're talking about self-control? This is what we're talking about. We're talking about the power to remain unflappable in our emotions and to regulate our actions at all times in order to reach an optimum outcome. How do we take care of our emotions, to control our emotions, also to control our actions for what? For the optimum outcome. Now, the idea of controlling oneself, it means two things, probably more, but at least two things that we know. The first is this, is that there must be the presence of something within us that needs to be bridled or controlled. Like, why would you need self-control if there was not something in you that needed to be bridled or restrained? And the second thing that we understand is that there is the possibility in us or through us for drawing on some power or some source of power in order to help us restrain this thing that needs to be restrained. Now, the Bible says this in Mark chapter 7, verse 20. This is what Jesus said. It is what comes from inside that defiles you. For from within, out of a person's heart, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, wickedness, deceit, lustful desires, envy, slander, pride, and foolishness. All these vile things come from within. They are what defile you. So Jesus is letting us know that there is something on the inside of us that wants to defile us, that wants to cause us to move in the wrong direction. And this is what James, the brother of Jesus, says in James chapter 1, verse 14. Temptation comes from our own desires, which entice us and drag us away. These desires give birth to sinful actions. And when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. And now death here is not just talking about death, like whenever you die and you cease to live on this earth. Death is a separation from life, that you are separated from the source of life. And when sin is allowed to grow and to rule and to take ownership in your life, it separates you from the very source of life. Now, let's remember this. Let's just take a moment and let's say, okay, there are thoughts, emotions, and desires in us that need to be restrained by a source of power that is within us. That's what we know about self-control. There is something in us that needs to be restrained. And there is power within us and power available to us in order to help us restrain that thing. Now, without God, what we're talking about is willpower. Every single one of us, every person on this planet has been given this thing called willpower. And we can all work that willpower in order to live with some type of self-control. But with God, guess what you get? You don't just get willpower, you also get His power. Because this is what the scripture says, the Holy Spirit produces it. So it is supernatural. So this is when God adds His super to your natural. So not only are you operating with willpower, but you are also operating with His supernatural power in your lives. And when Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 10, He says, I have come that you might have life, that you might have it to the full in abundance until it overflows. I think we would all agree that we could not live the abundant life without self-control. If we can't say no to what we need to say no to, and yes to what we need to say yes to, then we are not going to be able to live the abundant life. But the problem is, willpower has limits. His power has no limits. So we need the Holy Spirit to produce this supernatural element of self-control in our lives. And now, whenever we look at that word self-control in the original language, in the Greek, when it was written there, it actually means more than control. This is actually what the word means: dominion or mastery within. Dominion or mastery within. This shows us that biblical self-control is multifaceted. It involves both control over one's behaviors and control over the impulses and emotions beneath it. It includes our minds and emotions, not just our outward actions. And the Bible says this is what the Holy Spirit will produce in us. The Holy Spirit will produce this dominion and mastery over our attitudes and our actions. Now, this might be very challenging, maybe coming from your family culture. This might be very challenging growing up in the society that we have today. This might be a very challenging thought for people growing up, and maybe you've said things or you've heard things like, well, I just can't help it. Or maybe you've said, I just had to do it. Or maybe you've said or heard somebody say, I just woke up on the wrong side of the bed this morning. You know, chances are you probably got out of the same side of the bed you always get out on, but it's just something that we say. As a matter of fact, just a few weeks ago, Ella Francesca, our now five-year-old daughter, just had a birthday a couple weeks ago. She comes walking down the stairs one morning, and she's just a little grouchy, and her mom kind of greets her that morning, and man, she just was in a little bit of a foul mood. And I kind of heard what was happening in the living room. She comes walking in into the kitchen, and I say, "Hey, did we wake up? We a little grouchy day, a little bad attitude?" And she kind of mumbled some things under her breath. And I just said, "Hey, wait a minute." I said, "Hey, the Deas family, we don't do that. We don't do that in the Deas family. You don't get out of bed grouchy and in a foul mood." And I said, "Ella, what are our family core values?" She says, "Gratitude, generosity, and grit." And I said, "Okay, are you living with a lot of gratitude right now? Have you been thankful already this morning that you woke up, that you have a roof over your head, you have a mom and a dad here that love you? Are you experiencing gratitude?" "No." "How about generosity? Have you been thinking about how you can love and serve and give to your family around you? Are you thinking about others? You're only thinking about yourself?" "No, not living with generosity." "How about grit? Are you living with some toughness, with some perseverance, with some persistence? Are you living with grit?" "No, Dad, I'm not living in grit." And so I said, "Okay, this is what I want you to do. I want you to go sit in that chair in the living room, and I want you to sit there, and I want you to think, and I want you to think about our core values, and I want you to talk to yourself about what you are excited about happening today." Now, I finished what I was doing in the kitchen. I went and took a shower, and I came back out, dressed for it. I'm about to leave. And as I come back to the living room, man, she is just having so much fun, smiling. And I called her over, and I said, "Hey, Ella, did you sit down and talk to yourself?" She said, "Yes, sir. Yes, sir." I said, "What did you say?" She said, "I started talking to myself about today at 9:30, we have a babysitter coming over, and she's going to play dolls with me, and we're going to play games together, and we're going to have so much fun together." And I got so excited about what she was doing, and it happened just like that. Now, without her realizing what's happening, I am teaching her that she is in control of her emotions. Her emotions are not in control of her. And by taking control of her emotions, she can give direction to her actions. Now, while that may be a story of a five-year-old, here's the reality. The reality is that you and I both know that throughout the day, throughout life, throughout this week, there's going to be some thoughts and some feelings that just pop up. They just pop up. You're going to drive past a place or see a person, and these thoughts and feelings are just going to come up. You're going to have a memory. You're going to have a flashback. Maybe you're going to make a mistake at work this week, and as you make that mistake at work, man, all of these thoughts are going to come flooding into your mind. These are very real thoughts, very real feelings that you didn't necessarily want to show up, but they are showing up anyway. Things like this: "Man, I always screw good things up. Man, I am such an idiot. Nothing ever good is going to work out for me. Nobody will ever love somebody like me. Even past regrets, I should have. I wish I would have." Listen, you cannot control what pops up, but guess what? You can control what you do with that. You can't control the thought, the emotion in the moment. You can't control that. But you do have complete control over what you do with that. Let me take that one step further in Scripture. Scripture says you must control that. Not only can you control that, Scripture says you must have dominion and mastery within. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 25, verse 28, King Solomon writes this, and he says, "A person without self-control is like a city with broken down walls." I want you to think about that for a moment. A person with no self-control is like a city with broken down walls. No self-control, no walls, no boundaries. That means that anything and everything has unrestricted access to your mind and your heart. But if you have self-control, then you can have walls and you can have gates, and you are aware of what is coming and you are aware of what is going. You see, you cannot have dominion and mastery whenever you live with broken down walls. Remember, we're talking about dominion and mastery within. dominion and mastery within. I cannot always control what is happening to me. I cannot always control what is happening around me. But I have complete dominion and mastery over what happens in me. And you see, this is so important because most people allow moments to define them instead of them defining the moments. I'm going to say that again. Most people allow moments to define them instead of them defining the moment. People live their life to the soundtrack of what has happened to them. They live their life to the soundtrack of all the things that are happening around them, and they let that define their identity, and they let those events determine their future. So what they can't control is actually controlling them. When you think about that for a moment, what they can't control, what somebody said to them, what somebody did to them, what is happening around them in society, in our world today, they are letting what they can't control actually control them. Instead of saying, wait a minute, I have dominion over my thoughts. Wait a minute, I have mastery over my emotions. I get to define what this means to me. And by taking control of what they can control, their attitude, they actually gain control of their lives in their actions. This is what happened with Ella. My five-year-old that I was telling you about just a minute ago, she took control of her attitude. And when she took control of her attitude, her day had a different direction. When she took control of what she could control, then it sent her day in a different trajectory. And that's what happens. I love this quote from Leonardo da Vinci, and it says this: you can have no dominion greater or less than that over yourself. If you want to have dominion and mastery over your day, over your week, over your career, over your life, if you want to have dominion and mastery over anything, you will never have any dominion and mastery that is greater than the dominion and mastery that you have over yourself. And this is what the Holy Spirit wants to do. The Holy Spirit wants to produce this dominion and mastery within each and every one of us. Now, we've looked at this before, but I use this all the time. This is the transformational process, the transformational process. And it starts with believing and moves into our being. It results in our behaving. And then finally, it's the life that we are building. Everything in life starts with a belief. What are you believing? Now, out of that deep belief are going to come your thoughts, because your thoughts will never be out of alignment with your beliefs. You can get some thoughts in there, but they can't stay, not over time. Your thoughts are going to come from what you really believe. So if you say, man, I've got some stinking thinking in there, man, I think some bad thoughts, negative thoughts, pessimistic thoughts, I've got those thoughts, then somewhere in your life there is the wrong belief, because those thoughts are always coming from a belief. But if we get the right belief, now we can start thinking the right things. And what does that do? That takes me into the right being. That being is my identity, my character. It is who I am. Then how do I get into behaving? I begin to build habits. I begin to build habits out of my being, out of this person that I am. I start building habits in my life because there are behaviors that I want to see in my life. Why? Because the behaviors in my life are going to give me ultimately the life that I am building. And that life that I'm building is going to come through grit. Grit is the key. It's the connector between my behaving and the life that I am building. And I just define grit as this way. It is patience and persistence. It's the patience to be able to see that the harvest is coming, but it's a long way away. And the persistence to put my hand on the plow today and do what needs to be done so that we can see what is possible in the future. This is the transformational process. Now, I want to say once again, it's not what others have done to you, but it's what you do with what others have done to you that matters most. It's not just about what others have done to you. It's about what you do with what they've done to you that matters most. And that will always come back to our beliefs. It's going to always come back to our beliefs. You see people and they're building lives and their lives are broken and their lives are shattered and their lives are in crisis. And you say, how is that possible? It always starts with something that we believe. You know, there's a story in the Old Testament. It's a story of a guy by the name of Joseph. And Joseph was part of a big family. He was one of the younger brothers, had 12. And his dad really favored him, made him this beautiful coat. And his brothers were jealous. And one day they were out in the field, and his brothers got this great idea. Said, "Man, you know what we should do? We should just kill this guy. I mean, he's talking these crazy dreams, and man, that we're all going to bow down to him one day, and that God's favor, everything is on him. And man, we should just kill him." And they said, No, let's don't kill him. Let's actually sell him to the slave traders that come walking past here." And so that's exactly what they did. Here, Joseph, 17 years old, approximately, being sold into slavery. And over a series of events in the next 13 years of his life, which he experienced some amazing favor, he experienced some false accusations. He was in prison. He was being forgotten by people that he had helped. It ends with him. The story culminates at 30 years old, 13 years after being sold into slavery. It ends with him being elevated to basically being the vice president of Egypt. He's the second most powerful man right underneath Pharaoh himself. And then a famine hits the whole land, not just in Egypt, but the whole region. And guess who comes for food? And guess who Pharaoh had put in charge of the food distribution? That's exactly right. Joseph's brothers are coming for food. And Joseph has been put in charge of the food distribution. And of course, Joseph feeds them. And once again, through another series of events, he reveals his identity to them, helps them relocate into a fertile land there inside of Egypt, and he blesses them. And I mean, of course, you can imagine whenever Joseph revealed himself to his brothers, they were afraid, they were terrified. "We sold this guy into slavery. Now he's in a place of power. Is he going to kill us? What is going to happen?" Right? And now Joseph blesses them so much. And then we get here towards this end of the story. And now Jacob, Joseph's dad, he dies. And now all of the brothers are in a panic again. It hits them again. The same way it hit them when Joseph revealed himself to them, now they hit the panic button because, wow, they think he only did this because of dad. He only treated us this way because of dad. He's only been kind because of dad. And now dad is gone and he's not here anymore. And they find themselves in this, "Please don't kill us again" posture. But I want to bring your attention to Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. And this is what Joseph says to them. He says, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me to this position so I could save the lives of many people." You intended to harm me, but God intended it all for my good. He brought me to this position. God did it. God brought me to this position so that I could save many lives. You see, Joseph didn't allow the moment to define him. Instead, Joseph defined the moment. He didn't allow what happened with his brothers to define him. He didn't allow that moment when he was sold to those Ishmaelite slave traders. He did not allow that moment to define him. He didn't allow the moment where he was betrayed, where he was lied about. He didn't allow the moment where he was forgotten. He didn't allow any of those moments to define him. Instead, no, Joseph defined every moment himself. He took control of what he could control, and that was his beliefs. He said, "I am the one that get to write this story. I am the one that gets to determine what this means. I am the one that's in charge, and this is what I believe." And when he took charge of his beliefs, it set him in a course of elevating his mindset and thinking elevated thoughts, which did what? Which allowed his being, his character develop. It allowed him to become somebody so special on the inside. It gave direction to his behaving. So when he saw his brothers come begging for food, he wasn't in this place where it was time for him to get revenge. No, because he had a belief and he had thinking and he had this being and he was working all of this out. So when it came to his behavior, he was behaving towards them in a different manner than they had behaved towards him. And this was ultimately the life that he was building, being elevated to this position, loving his family, relocating his family, blessing his family, doing all of these things for so many. And it all came back to his belief. It came back to him taking control of what he could control. That was his beliefs. That was his attitude. And out of that belief and attitude would flow all of his behaving and his actions. See, this is the challenge for you, and this is the challenge for me, that we would live with that level of dominion and mastery within. Now, there are some things that we can do that can help us live with more self-control. Maybe we could say things that would help us live with more spontaneous self-control, in-the-moment self-control. And there are three things that we can do, and I would encourage you to do these three things that will help you increase your self-control. And the first is this, your mornings. Your mornings. You see, if you start your morning running late, you start your morning in chaos, you start your morning in a rush, getting everybody up, trying to get everything going, get everybody out the door. Guess what? You are already behind. Now, taking control of your morning, it probably means that you're going to have to do more of taking control of your evening and getting to bed earlier and being more organized on that side. Yeah, that's probably true. But if you take advantage of your morning, 20 or 30 minutes can make all the difference in the world. 20, 30 minutes to wake up and hydrate, drink 24 to 40 ounces of water, take some time to start stretching, take some time to read your Bible for prayer, for meditation, for journaling. 20 or 30 minutes each morning can make a difference. Listen, those 20 minutes of sleep are probably not going to make a difference in your day. But those 20 minutes invested in yourself every day will definitely make a difference in your life. I'm going to say that again. Those 20 minutes of sleep, probably not going to make a difference in your day. But 20 minutes invested into yourself will definitely make a difference in your life. I want you to say, you take 20 minutes a day, every single day. That is 7,300 minutes a year. That is 121 hours of investment into your life. You can read the whole Bible through in 75 hours. You could read your whole Bible and have 50 hours left over for prayer and meditation and stretching and whatever else it is that you want to do. Now think about if you did that for 10 years. We're talking 1,200 hours that you have invested in making sure that your day was better, therefore making sure your life was better. Now, I mean, you can just imagine if you just go up from 20 minutes a day and you say, okay, I want to get really organized. I want to stop wasting that time in the evening. I want to stop wasting all the time just scrolling on Facebook. I want to stop wasting that time up just scrolling through the channels. I want to stop wasting that time in the evening. I want to get to bed early so I can wake up. And then I take that time in the morning and say you go to 40 minutes or just double everything, 14,000 minutes. 242 hours that you could have every single year investing in yourself. You see, if you will take control of your morning, it will help you control yourself for the rest of the day. Here's the second thing that'll help you increase your self-control, and that's your inputs. You just have to ask yourself and be honest, what are you watching? What are you reading? Who are you listening to? Who do you follow on social media? What podcasts do you find yourself listening to? What about on television, YouTube? You see, if you're watching and listening and reading things that talk more about what you can't control, then your life is going to feel out of control and you're going to be more prone to live out of control. But if you're watching and reading and listening about how you can take control of your thoughts, how you can take control of your emotions, how you can take control of your life, then you are going to feel more in control and you are going to live more in control. And it has everything to do with the inputs that you are putting into your life. If you want to increase your self-control, make sure you are putting the right thoughts in your mind. And here's the last thing. The last thing is the crowd. The crowd. Who you spend time with will influence what you think about. Who you spend time with will also impact how you see yourself. Who you spend time with will also influence what you believe is possible in your life. You see, if you're around people that have no self-control, then chances are your self-control is not going to improve. So I want to ask you, is your crowd defined by what has happened? Or is your crowd defining what has happened? The people that you spend your time with, do you find that they are more victims or they are more victors? The people that you are doing life with right now, do they live in more of self-pity or do they live more in self-control? Because you see, whoever you are spending your time with, whoever you are allowing in your crowd, in your sphere of influence, they are influencing you in some direction. And if you don't like who they are, then you're not going to like where they are going to take you. So if you want to increase your self-control, you're going to have to get around people that have self-control. You're going to have to stop hanging out with the victims and get around some victors. You're going to have to get away from the people who are always having a self-pity party and get with the people who are growing in their own self-control. And the crowd is going to influence that in your life. And so if you just take that, you just take your mornings, you take your inputs, you take your crowds, right? Like we get just like a little crossy. It's your mic, right? It's your mic. You got the mic. You got the mic. Whoever has the mic has the control. You are in complete control of your self-control. You can either do things that are going to help increase your self-control, or you can drop the mic. And if you drop the mic, then you are giving other people the ability to control you. Other things have the ability to control you. Do not drop the mic. You take control. You take the mic and you take control of your own life. Dominion and mastery within. That's what the Apostle Paul was saying. This is what the Holy Spirit wants to do in us through the Spirit of Jesus, dominion and mastery within. And it is possible because the Spirit of Christ is living and dwelling on the inside of us. Hey, we're closing out all of our messages this year in our 2021, our year of application. And it's just a lead acrostic because we just believe before you're going to lead others, you got to lead yourself. And what does it look like to really lead yourself well? Well, you got to be learning, got to be evaluating, got to be applying, and then you just got to be faithful to do it again and again and again. And so today, what are we learning? What are we learning? This is our takeaway today. I should have dominion and mastery in my attitudes and actions. I should have dominion and mastery in my attitudes and my actions. Why? Not just because of willpower, but because of His power. Because the Holy Spirit is living on the inside of me. The evaluation. What's one area you can better control to increase your self-control? What's one area that we talked about? How about your mornings? How about your inputs? How about your crowds? What is one area right there that you can take better control of to produce better self-control all throughout the rest of your life? The application is this. Write down one thing you could do in that area right now and do it. Just write down one thing. Right there where you are. You can just type it into your phone. You can write it down in your notebook. What is one thing you could do in that area when it comes to your crowd? What is one thing that you can do in that area when it comes to your inputs? What is one thing that comes in that area in your mornings? What's one thing that you could add into that? What's one thing that you could do? And then the simple thing this week is just write it down and then just do that one thing. Don't make it 101 things. Just make it one thing. Just do that one thing this week. And then the D is always the same. Just do it again. Do it again. Do it again. Do it again. Keep gaining and keep growing in that dominion and mastery in your attitudes and your actions. And this is a process that never stops. It's not like we arrive. It's not like we're like, wow, look at us. Look at this supernatural love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and faithfulness and self-control. Wow, I am a finished product. Look at me. That will never, ever happen. This is a constant process in the life of a believer because supernaturally God is always revealing and producing greater love and greater joy and greater self-control in each and every one of our lives. Let me pray for you today. Father, thank you for your word. God, I thank you that you are good. I thank you that you are faithful. And God, I thank you that you are helping us along this journey. Holy Spirit, we want you to produce these things in us. We want that supernatural love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and faithfulness. Self-control. God, we want these things in us. Holy Spirit, continue to lead us and guide us. Continue to cause this fruit to grow in our lives as we all stay connected to the vine, the source of life, the one who is Jesus. Let us continue to produce this supernatural fruit in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray and believe. Amen, 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 amen. Hey, thank you so much. Don't forget, next week, starting a brand new series, Simple Prayers, and Sunday nights, 6 p.m. on the 15th, 22nd, and 29th of August, we're going to be praying right here in the sanctuary. We're going to have food and some fun afterwards. Do not miss it. 21 days of prayer. It's going to be exciting. I can't wait to go on this prayer journey with you. God bless you. We'll see you right back here next week.